We are about to begin our session. I see a performance by Asif soon. On behalf of Oxford University Press Pakistan, it is my privilege to welcome you all to the 8th Literature Festival, KLF-2017. Asif Sinan, a talented young musician known for blending Indian classical music with jazz, has the tonal quality of his guitar, which sounds almost like a sitar.
He has studied
music in the US and has performed across Pakistan and in the USA, Germany, Mexico, and India, to name a few other places. He will be opening the festival for us, Asif.
Okay, good evening, friends and honorable guests. अभी हाल ही में Oxford University Press के साथ एक collaboration मैंने किया था. तो सा effect थोड़ा कम कर दें इसमें. जैसे पाकिस्तानी anthem perform किया था. And today I would like to start with the anthem. But मैं चाहूँगा कि आप लोग आज खड़े ना हो और उस anthem को सुने और महसूस करें. And enjoy again. Thank you very much. next track is a Raag Kirwani. Or Raag Kirwani is basically a raga from Indian classical, but we insert some jazz scale also in it. I hope you will like and feel the blend of jazz and Indian classical. Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay. ओके कुछ यंगस्टर्स भी यहाँ मौजूद हैं और कुछ बहुत ज़्यादा यंग जिस तरह हमारे सर थैंक यू तो आप लोग गाना गाएंगे साथ मिलके ओके गाएंगे वाह ओके गाने के बोल हैं जाने दो एंड देन आने दो क्योंकि ये बिल्कुल भी ऐसा नहीं जो है जाए जाने दो पॉलिटिक्स से कोई लेने देना नहीं है क्योंकि मेरा नाम भी आसिफ है आसिफ सनान और एक और साहब हैं आसिफ जिन्होंने हमारे नाम को बहुत ऊपर लेके तो आई एम ट्राइंग टू बैलेंस द आसिफ एंड आसिफ आसिफ ओके ट्रैक एंड आई होप कि आप सबको पता होगा इस ट्रैक के बारे में इट्स सुफियाना कलाम माहियार दी खड़ोली थैंक यू Bali dum dum. My yard the cadoli birdie. So the yard the cadoli birdie. My yard the cadoli birdie. So the yard the cadoli birdie. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Asif, for a delightful performance. I'd like to invite on stage His Excellency Thomas Drew, the British High Commissioner, His Excellency Gautam Bambawale, High Commissioner of India, His Excellency Rainer Schmidtchen, Consul General of Germany, Grace Shelton, U.S. Consul General, Gianluca Rubagotti, Italian Consul, Philippe Crevoisier, Swiss Consul, André Debussy, French Cultural Attaché, Ayesha Jalal, Mustansar Hussain Tarar, Ali Raouf, Head of PepsiCo Franchise Business, Ali Habib, Head of Corporate Affairs and Marketing, United Bank Limited. Ameena Saiyid, OBE, Managing Director, Oxford University Press and Founder, Director, Karachi and Islamabad Literature Festivals and Co-Founder, Children's Literature Festival,
Asif, Farrukhi, founder Karachi and Islamabad Literature Festivals. Please take it. I would like to invite Ameena, Saiyid to please give the opening speech.
Mr. Ali Rauf, PepsiCo, Pakistan, Mr. Ali Habib, Head of Corporate Affairs and Marketing, UBL, His Excellency Thomas Drew, British High Commissioner, His Excellency Mr. Gautam Bambawale, High Commissioner of India, Rainer Schmeichen, Consul General of Germany, Grace Shelton, US Consul General, Dr. Ayesha Jalal, Mustansar Hussain Tarar, and distinguished ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu Alaikum. Welcome to the 8th Karachi Literature Festival, a celebration of books, authors, reading, music, film, and dance. The KLF is held to celebrate the rich, ancient, and diverse cultures and literatures of Pakistan so that they flourish and make an impact by becoming accessible to a wider public. We want to provide an opportunity and a platform for literary and cultural expression and for the release of creative energies while reaching out to provide free and open access to hundreds of thousands of people. This is a very inclusive festival, and we welcome and invite people from all over Karachi, from all nooks and corners of Karachi, and from all over Pakistan. KLF creates spaces where cultural and intellectual energies gain release, and we learn about today's world, about ourselves, and our history and civilization. And these are all questioned and debated critically. The speakers are not just the only ones who sit on the stage, but also those who raise questions. We want people from all over Karachi, indeed Pakistan, to engage in and enjoy cultural and intellectual activities. 1947 and partition are among the themes which our authors over this weekend will talk about, but there'll be other themes as well. The first KLF was launched in 2010 with great enthusiasm. It struck roots into people's minds and hearts and has since become a defining event on the intellectual calendar of not just Karachi, but also Islamabad, Lahore, Hyderabad, Faisalabad, and Larkana. We regard the Karachi Literature Festival as a journey or a movement. We want it to spread throughout Pakistan because we want people in this country to get to learn and to love books and reading and to become writers and to enjoy our rich culture. In May, we are taking the Karachi Literature Festival to London, where it will be held at the South Bank Center on the 20th of May, where we will celebrate Pakistan's culture and literature and the 70th anniversary of its creation. And we will be working in partnership with Bloomsbury Pakistan, which is a research collective in London, and with the Alchemy Festival. So it will be held at a very mainstream cultural venue in London. The Karachi Literature Festival has given birth to many other festivals, to music festivals, to a children's literature festival, and to a teacher's literature festival. So we hope that, as I said, that this becomes, and it indeed it has become, a movement. We have authors writing in diverse languages and genres from 11 countries, and we will have 80 sessions and 200 speakers over the next couple of days. There are 8 speakers from India, and we hope that KLF will help and strengthen friendship between Pakistan and India through such interactions and collaborations. I would like to thank the Indian High Commissioner for his wonderful support and for his presence here today. As one of the authors from India, Mr. Sudhindra Kulkarni, who is here today, he said this is not just a literature festival, but it is also a peace festival. Many literature prizes are awarded here at KLF. The Pepsi Best Nonfiction Prize, the KLF Peace Prize, the KLF Gets Farmer Best Fiction Prize, the KLF Infaq Foundation Urdu Literature Prize, the Italy Reads Pakistan Award, and many prizes awarded by UBL. I would like to thank our sponsors, without whom this would not have been possible. PepsiCo Pakistan, our title sponsor, UBL, Consulate General of the Federal Republic of Germany, the US Consulate General, the Manchester Literature Festival, with whom we have a partnership arrangement, the British Council, the Friedrich Ebert Stiftung Foundation, DAI Awaz, Tapal T, Omor, Infaq Foundation, Getz Farmer, the Consulate General of Switzerland, the British Deputy High Commission, the American Institute of Pakistan Studies, Indian Council for Cultural Relations, the Consulate of Italy, the Embassy of France, Goethe Institute, Emirates, Tehzeeb and Tehzeeb Foundation. I'd like to thank the wonderful KLF team, all my colleagues at Oxford University Press, Rahila Bakai, Zahra Naseem Haq, Muniza Ali, Anika Khokar, Sumer Qureshi, Zoha Amir, Faryal Farooq, Aman Aziz and his team, Salma Adil and her team, Irfan Ali, Asna Jamal, Faisal Usman, Batul Nasir, Sadia Mirza and Nadia Ghani. And special thanks to the mediators, Manhattan, and to Dinshaw Awari for facilitating this event. This event is actually directed and organized by Oxford University Press, which is a department of the University of Oxford. And it exists it has the same aims and objectives, which are the spread of scholarship and learning throughout the world. And it does this through the publication of books. OUP Pakistan has been in Pakistan since 1952. So we are only 5 years younger than the country itself. We now publish about 200 books every year, and we have bookshops. We are running 26 bookshops across Pakistan. And the whole idea is to make the access of books easy for people. Our latest bookshop is now going to be opened in Gilgit, because we found that people in Gilgit had difficulty accessing books. So welcome to this celebration of Pakistan's 70th anniversary, and a celebration of books, reading, and especially the spirit of inclusiveness, cultural expression, and peace. Thank you, and Assalamu Alaikum.
Thank you, Ameena. I would now like to invite Mr. Asif Farrukhi to share his views about Karachi Literature Festival.
Honorable dignitaries, distinguished guests, Khawatino Hazrat, Assalamu Alaikum. Welcome to the new edition of the Karachi Literature Festival, as it is all set to unfold on this pleasant day in a few moments from now. As we gather here this evening, there is more than a hint of change in the weather. The slight chill is going out of Karachi nights. Soon the days will be long and warm. And recently, I just heard a weather pundit announce that the spring will be much shorter in Pakistan this year. Rapid climate change reflects the dismal and despairing mood the world over. We in Karachi probably care less. as we know that the more the seasons change, the more they remain the same. The entire country is suffering right now from the lost season of Basant as kites disappear from the skies. With spring delayed and Basant gone, the only sure marker of the seasons is this Basant of books, which is a season by itself, coming to Karachi for the 8th time now. What does it promise? More sessions, more authors, more books this time. Nearly 200 writers, poets, scholars, and with a large number of them from the international community. This festival is particularly significant for our city, which has acquired a reputation for all the wrong reasons. Hospitality and acceptance of diversity certainly not being any part of this. The way the KLF has grown in the last 8 years, it has added another feature to city life. Here, presenting it as a city of books, a city going out of its way to connect with books and bringing readers in close proximity with readers. So as Ameena was saying, that it has really started a movement and we have festivals all over, maybe we should really think of Karachi Literature Festival as the mother of all literature festivals. I would have liked to talk about some of the distinguished sessions we are going to have, but that would not be fair. So there are a number of books which will be important for us to think about, look at them and hear them. मगर मैं एक बात और कहना चाहूँगा. कुछ दिन पहले मैं मसूद अशर के अफसाने पढ़ रहा था, जिनमें हर शख्स अपनी अपनी सच्चाइयों का दावेदार है. जितनी मेरी सच्चाई है वो दुनिया के लिए काफ़ी है. इनमें से एक अफसाने पर जैसे मेरी निगाह अटक गई. वो जुमला ये था, मेरे ख्वाब हमेशा दूसरे लोग ही देखते आए हैं, मैं तो इनके ख्वाबों की ताबीरों का खमियाजा भुगतने वालों में से हूँ. हमारे ख्वाब दूसरे लोग देखते आए हैं, मगर अपनी पसंद की किताबें तो हम पढ़ सकते हैं. हमारे ख्वाबों में से अभी किताबें गायब नहीं हुई हैं. अब शायद हमारी आँखों में उतरने वाले ख्वाब भी मस्तार हैं. हमारी अपनी कोई सच्चाई बाकी रह गई है तो हमारे अफसानों में, हमारे शायरी में. शायरी के और मध्यम और शोख रंग फहमीदा रियाज की नई नज़मों में मिलेंगे, किश्वर नाहिद की नज़मों में मिलेंगे, लेकिन इस बार एक अजीब खुशगवार इत्तेफाक हुआ है. जैसे कई सितारे गर्दिश करते करते एक साथ आ गए हैं. और मैं ख़ास तौर पे इस बात का जिक्र करना चाहूँगा कि शाहिदा हसन, नसीम सैयद और हुमैरा रहमान, जिन्होंने इस शहर से आगाज़ करके अब अपनी बस्तियाँ बड़ी दूर बसा ली हैं, वो शमाली अमेरिका से आई हैं और नए सफ़र के नई अलामतें और तलाजमें साथ लेकर आई हैं. शाहिदा हसन ने अपनी एक गज़ल में लिखा था, ढूंढ रहे थे जो मुझे, मिल तो गई उन्हें मगर, बर्फ़ के एक मकान में आग से खेलती मिली. बर्फ़ के एक मकान में आग से खेलती मिली. हमारे पुराने शायर आग से तो पहले भी खेलते रहे, मगर बर्फ़ का मकान एक नया मकाम है, एक नया इस्तारा. एक और जगह उन्होंने लिखा है, जलते रहे वो हर्फ में, बुझते रहे वो लफ्ज़ में, रोशनियों के खेल का जिनको हुनर दिया गया. हमारे दरमियान इस वक्त कितने ही हुनरबंद मौजूद हैं, आइए 3 दिन के लिए रोशनियों का खेल देखते हैं.
Thank you, Mr. Farrukhi. I now invite His Excellency Thomas Drew, British High Commissioner, to say a few words.
Good evening, everyone. This looks absolutely fabulous. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, I'm delighted to be here. Thank you to the organizers. Thank you to Ameena for inviting me. Looking at the program, I'm very conscious that I'm the third of what seems to be many warm-up acts for the main show. I'm also conscious that most people don't come to a literature festival to listen to bureaucrats. So I'll keep my comments as short as I can, but I will abuse my position on the stage, if I may, to make a few comments. The first thing is, some of you may know, I served here 10 years ago, and looking at the changes in Pakistan since then, I think one of the nice changes for good that I've seen is actually the development of this culture of literature festivals. And I think we in the UK are very much delighted to have supported this particular festival from the early days, and personally, I never thought I'd be standing in front of a stand with my own university's crest next to it, but that adds a little extra little bit of pleasure for me. There are a lot of cliches out there about the power of literature. In many ways, these are cliches because they're true. I saw it during my last trip to Peshawar a few weeks ago when I had a tour of the Indus Valley School, and I actually even saw it this morning when I saw Sadakan's portrayal of William Shakespeare in the State Bank Museum on the 30th anniversary of his death today. And what a fabulous piece of work that was. And it's a side of Pakistan that certainly I would like people in the UK to see more of. The second thing I want to do is a quick plug, I suppose. And I saw for the first time a sense of the power of literature here when I opened the new British Council Library here in Karachi last year. And incidentally, if you haven't seen it, there's a pop-up version of the library in the grounds of the festival today. And I was struck by, first of all, the massive enthusiasm for the books and everything it had to offer, including the coffee shop. But also I was struck, too, by the personal emotion around this particular library. The number of people who came to me and talked about when their parents had taken there in the early days beforehand, but when it had closed, or even people who had met their future husbands and wives in the library, I'm sure it happens in most countries. And the third thing I want to say is how great the international dimension is as well. I mean, it's great to see some of my friend and colleague, the Indian High Commissioner here, the French, Germans, Indians as well. And of course, we have a great British representation here. You heard a little bit about it from Ameena and the particular plans for the Karachi Literature Festival in London later this year. The British Council has been great in bringing across some British authors here, especially for the festival. Shrabani Basu, Mirza Wahid, for example, and again, seeing old British friends in the audience, Victoria Schofield, for example. And as Ameena said, of course, it's Pakistan's anniversary, the 70th anniversary, but we too are very keen to mark that, and we'll see a whole range of cultural events on the British side, not just literature, but on art, museums, architecture, throughout the year, and it's a great way to start it by starting the Karachi Literature Festival. Anyway, I promised I'd be short. The most important thing I want to say is really enjoy the time. It looks like a great program, and we're very happy to be supporting it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Your Excellency. I now invite His Excellency Gautam Bambawale, the High Commissioner of India, to share his thoughts.
Thank you very much. It's a great delight to be with all of you here. I can promise you one thing. I'll be even shorter than my colleague, Tom. Ladies and gentlemen, friends, I'm delighted to join all of you at this inaugural session of the 8th Karachi Literature Festival. The festival has grown in size and scope over the past few years, and is now an important, prestigious event in the cultural life of your very beautiful city, Karachi. I congratulate Mrs. Ameena Saiyid and the organizers of the Karachi Lit Fest on the great success of this event. I'm very happy that several writers and authors from India have been invited to this year's festival. They come from all corners of India and hence truly represent my country. I thank the Indian Council for Cultural Relations, who readily agreed to sponsor some of this Indian participation. I'm sure they will contribute positively to your deliberations and interactions. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm told that this year's Karachi Literature Festival commemorates the 70th anniversary of Pakistan's independence. On such an occasion, perhaps some introspection may not be out of place. India wishes Pakistan well in its nation-building processes. India wishes to see a stable, moderate, and prosperous Pakistan. India wishes to see a Pakistan which is at peace with itself, at peace with its neighbors, and at peace with the world at large. India wishes to see a Pakistan which abjures violence and takes strong preventive action against terrorists and extremists. India wishes to see a Pakistan which does not distinguish between good and bad terrorists, but instead moves against all such elements, irrespective of whom their hatred is directed against. Friends, I am confident that over the next 2.5 days, you will debate and discuss all these and many, many other issues. I know your deliberations are followed widely and your recommendations carry weight. I extend my very best wishes for the success of the 8th Karachi Literature Festival. Thank you for listening to me.
Thank you, Your Excellency. I invite His Excellency Rainer Schmidtschein, the Consul General of Germany, to say a few words.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We Germans are happy to join KLF again. And the Germans are not only the German consulate, this is also the Goethe Institute, the German Cultural Institute. Some of you might remember me mentioning Gutenberg in my KLF speech last year. It was Gutenberg who triggered a kind of media revolution by inventing a new method of printing, thus making books affordable to many. And I also mentioned the revolutionary effects of the internet, making information and communication accessible to everyone at practically no cost. 1 year later, something that we are subject of another revolution. Results of elections are said to be influenced by fake news and by modern media as such. I am not sure whether this is something new, but I am sure that the intellectuals in our societies, in first instance the journalists, the writers and the authors, have an ever-increasing responsibility to provide credible information. I think that this responsibility should include bridging emotional borders through storytelling. To quote the headline of an article in the Indian, on the Indian partition, in the memories of different generations, recently published in Express Tribune. Bridging borders leads me to the German highlight of the KLF, namely the German Peace Prize. The award ceremony on this prize is scheduled for tomorrow, 11 February at 12:15. In room 007, by the way. The German Peace Prize as first, second, and third prize is awarded this year for the first time, and we confirm that our prize will remain in future what it is meant for, to make the public aware of outstanding literary contributions which promote peace between countries, interreligious harmony, as well as tolerance in the sense of open-mindedness. What else do the Germans contribute to KLF 2017? Let me mention Mr. Ilya Troyanov, a novelist who came to read and to interact with Pakistani colleagues. Furthermore, I am proud to announce that Dr. Christina Oesterheld, accompanied by her colleague Amtul Tahir, both from University Heidelberg, came to Karachi to present their textbook for learners of Urdu. This is the textbook for all Germans who want to learn Urdu. By the way, once Christina was a junior professor at my alma mater, the Humboldt University in Berlin, teaching South Asian languages and South Asian literature to students like me. Christina will speak in 3 KLF panels tomorrow and on Sunday. Another very special German contribution to KLF 2017 should be mentioned. It is a graphic novel, and I'm happy to say that what we see here is nothing less than the first ever German-Pakistani comic project implemented in cooperation between students of Karachi School of Art, Karachi University, Indus Valley School of Art, together with Klaus Schleiter, a comic artist from Berlin. The German artist and 20 students from Karachi formed a creative team for 1 week, worked together in our consulate. Remembering this week of creativity, of happiness, I still feel that many borders were bridged between Germans and young Pakistanis. What a nice effect of art, of literature, and of reading. Ladies and gentlemen, to conclude, I would like to thank the marvelous team of the KLF. I think we all agree that KLF is one of the most important cultural events in all of Pakistan. Ameena, Dr. Farrukhi, you can be proud of that. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you for your kind words, Your Excellency. I'd like to invite Grace Shelton, the U.S. Consul General, to share her views.
I'm a little shorter. Assalamu alaikum. Good evening to the members of the Diplomatic Corps, leading authors, artists, journalists, and academics from throughout Pakistan and from the whole world. It's such an honor to be here to help inaugurate the 8th Annual Karachi Literature Festival. I'd like to offer my heartfelt congratulations to Managing Director of Oxford University Press, Ameena Saiyid, and renowned author Asif Farrukhi, and all of their hardworking staff for organizing yet another successful festival. Looking around, the excitement in the air is palpable. I'm especially proud that this year, the U.S. Consulate General is once again sponsoring, as a co-sponsor of the Karachi Literature Festival. Over the past 7 years, KLF has become the most anticipated event on Karachi's cultural calendar. Year after year, the festival has continued to attract larger and larger audiences, including visitors and participants from overseas who have come to see the cultural renaissance that is going on all around us in Karachi. More than just an inspiring forum of a diverse range of workshops, KLF has become an international platform engaging all walks of life to debate, learn, and appreciate our shared cultures. KLF is important for so many reasons. As it has in the past, this weekend will provide a chance for new conversations, connections, and meetings of the mind among people from throughout Pakistan and around the world. I loved it when Ameena said that it's making creative spaces. By the end of the weekend, we will have attempted to understand each other better. And in that process, we will have also encountered new books and new ideas that just maybe change the way we think about topics of the day. One of the many reasons that the United States government is a continued supporter of the KLF is because of the important role it plays in literacy and academic dialogue. By facilitating contacts between talented artists and academics from our two countries and from around the world, from all of us up here, we lay the groundwork for future collaboration and mutual understanding. KLF's expansion to include a children's literature festival shows its commitment to Pakistan's youth. We share that commitment. And support for literacy programs is one of the U.S. government's key objectives in education initiatives in Pakistan. Through U.S. assistance, we are helping 1.7 million Pakistani children learn to read. Like the KLF, thank you. Like the KLF, we want to increase venues for people to read and make books accessible. U.S. government-sponsored Lincoln Corners throughout Pakistan offer books, magazines, and quiet places to read and study. The schools we're building throughout Sindh will also have libraries that are open to the students and the communities around those schools. And I'm also happy to point out our bookmobile that's right back there. I hope everybody gets a chance to visit it. It's really cool. Hand in hand with literacy is critical thinking, a crucial element in any society's continued progress. Building resiliency and critical thinking while kids have fun is important not just here in Pakistan, but also around the world. Once again, I'd like to congratulate all the organizers and volunteers who have worked so hard to make this year's festival possible. There are so many interesting panels that I'm sure all of you are like me and just wish we could clone ourselves so we could attend multiple ones. But I think it's going to be a fascinating weekend, and I hope to see you again tomorrow and on Sunday when we have our own panels on arts and culture and cultural preservation. Thank you and enjoy the festival. Shukriya.
Thank you, Ms. Shelton. I now invite Mr. Gianluca Rubagotti, the Italian consul, to share his thoughts.
Good evening to all of you. What a pleasure being here in such a stimulating environment. The organization has allocated me with 2 minutes, which I think can be enough if you really have something to say. Since Italy is a country where alter culture are still highly regarded, I was very happy last year to come here to announce the launch of Italy Reads Pakistan Award in collaboration with Metropoli d'Asia, which is an Italian publishing house based in Milan, whose founder, Andrea Berrini, is sitting here with us. With a view to translating into Italian language a contemporary novel by a Pakistani author, as a strong sign of friendship between our two countries and our two peoples. After 1 year, we have the winner, and I would be very tempted to announce it here now, but I think this time it's better if I try to resist the temptation, and I prefer inviting you all tomorrow at 11 a.m. for the panel Italy Reads Pakistan Award, where the winner will be announced. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gianluca Rubagotti. I now invite Mr. Philippe Crevozier, the Swiss consul, to share his thoughts.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. As you can see, I was not really prepared to have a speech tonight, so I will just take the opportunity to thank the Festival Organization Committee for the preparation of this event. This is the first time Switzerland is participating, as far as I know, to this festival. So for us, it's something new, and we appreciate to be part of it. We are here represented by one Swiss author, Mrs. Regula Boob, who is the wife of a former ambassador to Pakistan. She is with us tonight, and she presents her book called High Life in Pakistan. I really motivate you to read this book about your country. It's also an honor for Switzerland to ensure the artistic part of the festival this year with an exhibition made by students of 5 universities of Pakistan, 2 of them in Karachi, Indus Valley and Karachi University. And you can see the exhibition throughout the weekend here at the Avari Beach Luxury Hotel. So have a successful festival, and thank you for listening.
Thank you, Mr. Crevozier. I invite Mr. André Debussy, the French cultural attaché, to say a few words.
So if I understand, the competition today is who's going to make the shortest speech, and I'm trying to win it. French embassy is quite happy to be part of the literature festival since the beginning. We've been involved in literature in this country back to the 60 years with the opening of the three French Alliance Française in Islamabad, Karachi, and Lahore. So here in Karachi, it's not only the Consulat General who is involved in supporting literature, but also the Alliance Française. We have been able this year to have two of our best scholars to come to Karachi, namely David Waterman and Paul Verret. They will be here for the next 2.5 days. The history of cooperation with the festival is also personal friendship with Ameena. Ameena made herself available for to come to France in December, where she spent a whole week visiting editors, book printers, and also a festival of literature for youth. We have built a very strong relationship with Ameena, and therefore from then on we will build new programs of cooperation. So once again, Ameena and Farrukhi, congratulations for this initiative, and I wish you well, all of you, two excellent days. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Debussy. I now invite Mr. Ali Rauf, head of PepsiCo franchise business, to share his thoughts.
Dear ladies and gentlemen, august audience, our diplomatic corps, Ameena Saiyid, and everybody, Karachi, I, on behalf of PepsiCo, welcome you to the Karachi Literary Festival. We at PepsiCo take an immense pride and pleasure to be associated with such a fantastic event, which is in right direction, building up the nation and bringing up a change in our young generation. So PepsiCo commits that we shall be continue to be associated with this event. And I would like to congratulate Ms. Ameena Saiyid for this event and such a fantastic gathering, and also providing us an opportunity to interact with each other and to share our thoughts. William Shakespeare says that there is a tide in the affairs of men which, taken at the flood, leads on to fortunes. So I hope that such a festival will become a true building block for us as a nation to move forward in the right direction and to bring a change wherein we can enjoy and rejoice. So want to close, since being this literary festival, want to close upon the lines of W.H. Auden when he says that light a candle of knowledge with a stroke of pen and set it ablaze, twinkling like stars in darkness in the milky horizon of mind. Thank you very much. Good luck.
Thank you, Mr. Rauf. I now invite Mr. Ali Habib, the head of corporate affairs and marketing, United Bank Limited, to share his thoughts.
Thank you. Ms. Ameena Saiyid Sahaba, Asif Farrukhi Sahab, Excellencies, Ambassadors, Council Generals, High Commissioners, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu Alaikum. When I look at the Karachi Literature Festival, what strikes me not is the sheer number of people that will attend in the next 3 days. What strikes me not is the meticulous planning that has gone into making this event possible. What strikes me actually is the sheer perseverance, the commitment required to take an idea and turn that into reality year upon year for the 8th year running. For this commitment, this perseverance, I would like to congratulate the organizers and the founders of the Karachi Literature Festival. Let's give them a big hand. This is the second time that UBL has been associated with the Karachi Literature Festival. And invariably, I get a question from friends or acquaintances, and they say, "Tum to bank ho. Tum literature festival mein kya kar rahe ho?" And invariably every year I try to come up with a more cogent answer for this particular question. And this time the answers are three, essentially. First, UBL is a bank that came into being in 1959, and its own history is intertwined with the 70-year-old long history, the economic, financial, and social history of Pakistan. The bank is not only just a financial institution, but actually a part of the social fabric of the country. We have 13,000 people working for the bank. We have operations that extend from Gilgit to Gawadar. We serve 4 million people in Pakistan, 40 lakh logon ko. When you are operating on a scale of this magnitude, you become part of the society. It is then incumbent upon you to work for the betterment of that society in whatever way you can. Mujhe is mauke pe wo faraz ka sher yaad aa jata hai ke shikwa zulmat shab se to kahin behtar tha apne hisse ki koi shamma jalate jate. Let us not bemoan. My translation for the couplet might not be that accurate, but it goes something like, let us not bemoan the darkness of night that envelops us. Let us light a candle to dispel the darkness. So that's the ethos with which UBL participates in the Karachi Literature Festival as a part of our activity to make something better for the society. A matter of trivia, and that comes to the second point, is that a giant of Urdu literature, Janab Mushtaq Ahmad Yusufi, was UBL's president 40 years ago. So that's a trivia that some of you should be aware of. Continuing with the trivia, the great humorist, the great artist, Anwar Maqsood, started his professional career working with UBL in 1967. So that's our second association with literature. The third reason that I think Karachi UBL is part of the Karachi Literature Festival is that this is a platform through which UBL extends its own UBL Literary Awards. Tomorrow in the Jasmine Hall at 4:45 in the evening, UBL will be hosting its sixth UBL Literary Excellence Award, in which we identify seven categories, and through a process of rigorous process of getting nominees, and then those nominees are sent to an august panel of which Asif Farrukhi Saab is also a member, we sort of narrow them down to the seven winners. So tomorrow at 4:45 in the evening at the Jasmine Hall is the sixth UBL Literary Awards. I would request you all to join us there and be there to encourage the budding talent that exists in Pakistan and in the literature field. Once again, I'd like to thank the organizer, Ameena Sayyid Sahiba, Asif Farrukhi Saab, for creating this platform that dispels a lot of negative news that we as Pakistanis get to hear from the international media. Pakistan is a vibrant country. We are proud of it. UBL is here as Pakistan embarks on its 70th year. Inshallah, UBL will be here when Pakistan embarks on its 140th year. Till then, have a good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Assalamu alaikum.
Thank you, Mr. Rauf. It is now time for the announcing the Best Book Awards. I would like to invite Mr. Ashraf Jahangir Qazi, jury member of the KLF Pepsi Non-Fiction Prize, to announce the winner.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. It's a great honor and pleasure for me to be here to announce the winner for the non-fiction book of the year, written by a Pakistani, published by the Oxford University Press. There were around 30 books from which the panel had to choose, and I was delighted to find that we were confronted with an embarrassment of riches, because the quality of the non-fiction writing was so good. So many books were so distinguished on a whole range of subjects, from history to personal memoirs to architecture, culture, music, memoirs, history of ideologies, history of narratives, etc. It took us several rounds to narrow the field down to 3 books, and I can tell you it was nearly impossible for us to choose which one was the book to get the prize, because any of these three books would have been worthy winners of the prize. I mentioned in no particular order The Raj at War by Yasmin Khan, and Surkh Salam by Kamran Asdar Ali, and The Book of Conflict, The Chechnama and Muslim Origins of South Asia by Manan Ahmed Asif. Each of these books were truly excellent. One about the people's participation from the subcontinent, or the soldiers' participation in World War II, which showed not only in meticulous detail brought to life of how this world war became part of the history of the people of the subcontinent, even though it was not their war. It was a war that they, as we say in Urtawan Wakarhan, despite their will or lack of will, they simply had to participate in it. And 2.5 million soldiers from the subcontinent, which means if you add their families and their parents and their it would be about 25, 30 million people, which is a very large, huge segment. And therefore, it is part of our historical narrative, the experience that are so beautifully explained in this book. And it's an absolute must read. As far as Surkh Salam, Communist Politics and Class Activism in Pakistan, this fills an absolutely essential void in reading the history of the politics of Pakistan, because the communist and socialist movement in Pakistan was essentially in response to an idealistic, humane response, which is particularly relevant in poor and developing countries. And these are people who didn't just sit around and talk. These are the people who engaged in active politics in order to try and realize their ideals, suffered hugely, dislocation, jail, ill treatment, torture, the worst, but for them there was an ideal. This ideal appears, with the collapse of the Soviet Union, not to have succeeded, but that would be a very wrong interpretation, because the socialist ideal is an ideal of the aspirations of the common people. That can never die, and that will be revived in Pakistan. And then finally, A Book of Conquest, the Chechnama and Muslim Origins of South Asia. This again is just an equally riveting book about how the received narrative of the Muslim introduction to the subcontinent has been received for decades, indeed for centuries. And this is through the author's reinterpretation of a book written about 7 centuries after Muhammad bin Qasim came here, and to show that Islam in India was not just the event that took place in the 8th century. It was how the indigenous people's dynamics gave rise, as a result of this event, to the emergence of Islam as a culture, as a polity, as an essential part of the history of the subcontinent. Three fabulous books. In the end, of course, we did arrive at a consensus, and it was not to sort of keep you waiting any longer. The book that is winner by consensus after many rounds of discussions, including differences, is The Raj at War, a peep by Yasmin Khan. Thank you very much.
I would like to request Mr. Ali Rauf to present the KLF Pepsi Nonfiction Prize to Sara Ansari on behalf of Yasmin Khan. Okay. Seema will be sharing a small message on behalf of Yasmin.
Good evening, everybody. Your Excellencies, Ameena Saiyid, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Very honored to be here to accept this award on Yasmin Khan's behalf. A small message from her, I'm reading as she has sent it to me. Thank you so very much to the organizers of the Karachi Literature Festival for this wonderful honor. Sincere thanks. I'm especially pleased to receive a prize in my father's childhood city and to have members of my family here tonight. Thank you also to my publisher, Penguin Random House, and all who have supported me along the writing path. I would like to donate the prize money to the Charles Wallace Pakistan Trust. The Trust awards grants to academic researchers and artists who wish to come to Britain for a short period of time with the aim of broadening their professional knowledge and skills. I'm very sorry not to be with you here in person due to teaching commitments in Oxford, but I look forward to attending the KLF again very soon. Thank you.
Thank you, Seema, and thank you to Yasmin for her generous gesture. Mr. Ali Rauf has just stepped out, and once he arrives, then he'll be presenting the prize. So if you could just take a seat there. I would like to invite Munisa Shamsi, jury member of the KLF Gets Pharma Fiction Prize, to announce the winner.
Mrs. Ameena Sayed, Mr. Asif Farrukhi, honorable speakers, honored guests, Assalamu alaikum. It gives me great pleasure to announce the KLF Gets Pharma Prize today. I'd like to say what a very great pleasure it was to serve on a jury with Naz Asanuddin and Razeshta Setner. My fellow judges and I were delighted at the books submitted for the prize, and both the long list and the short list reveal the diversity of the work we received. The short list, which was announced earlier, consisted of Dear Yasmin by Safiya Khan, The Spinner's Tale by Omar Shahid Hamid, Karachi Raj by Anish Shivani. We had to deliver quite a lot, but the winner we chose was exceptional, we felt, for the multi-layered plot, the real but unusual and complex characters, and a narrative which reflects the age in which we live. And the winner is The Spinner's Tale by Omar Shahid Hamid.
Omar Shahid Hamid is the winner. Congratulations, Omar Shahid Hamid. I would like to invite Dr. Khawar Mehdi, Director Corporate Communication gets Pharma to give the prize to Omar Shahid Hamid. Dr. Mehdi. Omar Shahid Hamid, he's there.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to share a few words about the CSR at Getz Pharma. We are committed to sharing our success with community at large and amongst all segments of the society. The primary goal of CSR model is to successfully integrate corporate responsibility concerns, social, environmental, and economic into company values, culture, operations, and business decisions at all levels. This is how we envision a corporate social responsibility, doing business ethically and in an environmentally and socially responsible manner while safeguarding growth and profits in line with the expectation of our stakeholders. Our CSR has four major pillars. The first is preservation of our cultural heritage, arts and literature, which is the foremost. Then education and skill building for the underprivileged. The third is preservation of the environment. And finally, it's health for the underprivileged. We'll come to the award. And as Pablo Picasso once said, art is a lie that makes us realize the truth. So fiction is not that different. And our author, Mr. Omar Shahid Hamid, is a sound storyteller who makes sure to keep the reader both at the local and global level, well absorbed through sustained engagement, right from the first page to the last word in his manuscript. Those who are expecting a lot of sensational and frightening encounters would for sure be surprised. In short, the author's work honors fiction and its engaging plot without compromising on the entertaining flow. The fact is that Omar's graceful vocabulary, engaging writing, captures your imagination and ensures that one enjoys the novel in spite of, or maybe because of, the very disturbing and disruptive undercurrents and the ambiguously charming dynamics. Ladies and gentlemen, fiction is the light of living societies, and Omar Shahid Hamid has done one good job in keeping it lit. Thank you. Congratulations, Omar. On behalf of Getz Pharma, I would like to
congratulations, Mr. Hamid. I would like to invite Arfa Sayeda Zehra.
Oh, sorry,
Mr.
My apologies. High Commissioners, Consuls General Ameena and Asif Saab, all the sponsors and partners of the KLF. I haven't prepared really. This is a bit overwhelming, but it's tremendous and a great honor for me to win this prize in what is my home literary festival. So thank you all, and thank you to all of those who read the book and who enjoyed it.
Thank you. I would now like to invite Arfa Sayeda Zehra to announce the winner of KLF Infaq Urdu Literature Prize.
معزز خواتین و حضرات, تمام مقتدرین جو یہاں تشریف فرما ہیں, جو اردو سمجھتے ہیں یا اردو نہیں سمجھتے, جو نہیں سمجھتے وہ بھی کچھ نقصان میں نہیں ہیں, اور جو سمجھتے ہیں ان کا بھی کوئی فائدہ نہیں ہے. لیکن ایک بات دل کو بڑھاوا دیتی ہے, اس کو خود ستائی مت جائیے گا, مگر میں یہاں یہ اظہار تشکر کرنا چاہتی ہوں کہ جشن ادب کی 8th سالگرہ ہے, آکسفرڈ یونیورسٹی پریس اس کا میزبان ہوتا ہے, और ये सेहरा दो लोगों के सर पे बैक वक्त बनता है और उसमें मेरी तौकीर ये है और मेरे लिए बेहद खुशी का सामान है कि आठवां साल है और मैं यहाँ हाजिर होती हूँ। तो उर्दू में अगर तुतलाने लगूँ तो आठ साल की उम्र देखते हुए माफ़ कर देना चाहिए। दूसरी बात यह कि जिस किसी को ये ख्याल है कि उर्दू एक कमज़ोर नातवां मरती हुई ज़बान है, वो आज अपने दिल से ये ख्याल को धो डाले। खुद उर्दू बोलने वाले शर्मिंदा शर्मिंदा से रहते हैं, उनकी वजह शर्मिंदगी भी मेरी समझ में इसलिए नहीं आती कि ये आज जिस किताब का मैं ज़िक्र करने को हूँ और जो ख़ुद उर्दू के लिए एक बड़ा टेढ़ा सा मामला है। हम अफसाना बहुत शौक़ से पढ़ते हैं और शेर पर उससे ज़्यादा सर धुनते हैं, चाहे उसके काफ़िए तंग हों या उसकी बहरें बहरुल काहिल से मिल जाती हों, लेकिन हमें लुत्फ़ देता है और हम सोचते हैं कि उर्दू इसी का नाम है। उर्दू एक तहज़ीब की संजीदगी का नाम है। उर्दू अपने अंदर एक बात बरसों पहले लेकर आई जो ऑक्सफ़ोर्ड यूनिवर्सिटी प्रेस का जश्न दोबारा से दोहरा रहा है कि गले मिलने से ज़िंदगी तवाना होती है, फतवे देने से नहीं। उर्दू को ये नाज़ मयस्सर है कि वो कोई एक अकेली ज़बान नहीं है। कितनी ज़बानें हैं जो उसके मिजाज और ख़मीर में दाखिल हैं, और जब ज़बानें किसी के ज़मीर और मिजाज में दाखिल होती हैं तो वो ज़बानें अपनी वो शनाख्त पैदा करती हैं जो तन्हा करने की बजाय यकता करती हैं। तन्हाई तो उनका मुकद्दर है जो ज़िद्द करते हैं, जो किसी की बात सुन लेते हैं और समझ लेते हैं, वो कभी तन्हा हो नहीं सकते। किताब पढ़ने से ज़्यादा कोई चीज़ पुरलुत्फ नहीं। कागज़ का लम्स रोशनाई की रोशनाई, और उस परों की तरह से खुलते हुए वर्कों की खुशबू, वो अभी भी कंप्यूटर अलैहिस्सलाम के काबू में नहीं आए। इस दफ़ा बहुत किताबें शायरी की थी और इस दफ़ा बहुत किताबें अफसाने के, और हम ये सोचते हैं कि जब उर्दू अफसाने की बात आती है तो हमेशा हीरोइन उंगली दांतों में दबा लेती है, हीरो खबासत से मुस्कुराते हैं और इस तरह ज़िंदगी बहुत कामयाब हो जाती है। उर्दू अफसाना इससे कहीं आगे निकल गया। आज उर्दू अफसाने के एक संगे मील को गिरे हुए एक बरस होता है, और मैं अभी पिछले दिनों कह रही थी कि पिछले साल तक हम कहते थे कि हम अहद इंतज़ार में ज़िंदा हैं कहानी के, और इस साल ये कहती हूँ कि हम कहानी के इंतज़ार में ज़िंदा हैं। इसलिए इस साल की जो किताब है न शायरी है न कहानी, बात तनकीद पर उतर आई, बात मीज़ान पे ठहरी, बात इस बात पे ठहरी कि बात को तोला कैसे जाए, और जब तोला जाए तो उसमें बदनीयती न की जाए, उसमें अंग्रेज़ी का बघार भी मत लगाइए, उसमें फ्रांसीसी की खुशबू भी मत फैलाइए, उसको उर्दू का पैमाना रहने दीजिए, क्योंकि हर ज़बान अपने पैमाने से पनपती है, हर कौम भी अपने पैमाने से पनपती है, हर माशरा भी अपने पैमाने से। इस दफ़ा उर्दू की जो तनकीद की किताब है उसका इनाम जनाब नासिर अब्बास नैयर साहब को जाता है। मेरे जिम्मे ये काम था कि मैं इस छुपे हुए नाम को आप तक पहुंचा दूं, आपकी हिनायत और आपके तवज्जो का बेहद शुक्रिया.
शुक्रिया सैयदा. आरफा सैयदा जहरा साहिबा. आई वुड नाउ लाइक टू इनवाइट रेयर एडमिरल रिटायर्ड सैयद ए बाकर, Chief Executive, Infaq Foundation, to present the KLF Infaq Foundation Prize to Umair Lodhi on behalf of Nasir Abbas Nair.
بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم. السلام علیکم اینڈ شام بخیر لیڈیز اینڈ جینٹلمن. اٹ از مائی پلیجر ٹو اسٹینڈ بیفور یو آن دس 8th کے ایل ایف اوارڈ سیرمنی. ایٹ دی آؤٹ سیٹ آئی وڈ لائک ٹو تھینک مسز امینہ سید اینڈ مسٹر آصف فاروقی, فاؤنڈرز آف دس کوویٹڈ ایکسٹراویگینزا, برنگنگ ٹوگیدر سو مینی بک لورز, writers and literary personalities. This platform has enabled Infaq Foundation to sponsor the awards and promote literary activities in the country. Infaq Foundation founder late Mr. Agha Sanabdi founded the organization to promote, amongst the other services, literary undertakings by organization and individuals. Toward this end, we joined KLF to award the Best Urdu Literature or Fiction Award for the current year. This year, it's the Literature Award. Apart from this modest undertaking of Infaq Foundation, which invests heavily in education and health sector all over the country, Foundation has established a separate entity known as the Center for Development of Social Services, almost 30 kilometers from here, to promote education from pre-primary to graduate level, basic health facilities, women empowerment, and skill development. All our 2,500 beneficiaries in this complex are most deserving and belong to underprivileged section of the society, whom we are trying to bring into the mainstream. 2 years ago, Infaq Foundation also undertook to promote professional development of teachers belonging to schools all over Karachi, totally free. We have already expanded this activity to the coastal town of Urmara, and we plan to enter other cities this year. I congratulate Mr. Nasir Abbas Nair for having won the award this year for his book in Urdu, The Urdu Adab Ki Tashkeel-e-Jadeed. Big hand to him. I'm sure this will give not only to him but to other young writers to work hard in promoting and enriching our national language. Thanks also to the 3 judges who undertook to read the books, several books, to find the best in the consensus opinion. Thank you very much.
Our congratulations to Mr. Nair. Thank you, Admiral Bakar. Mr. Ali Rauf has now joined us. I would like to request him to please award the prize to Ms. Seema Ansari on behalf of Yasmin Khan. This is the KLF Pepsi Nonfiction Prize. Congratulations to all the winners. I would like to invite Dr. Ayesha Jalal, Mary Richardson Professor of History at Tufts University, USA, to deliver the keynote speech. Professor Jalal is the author of numerous publications, including The Sole Spokesman, Jinnah, The Muslim League and the Demand for Pakistan, and Partisans of Allah, Jihad in South Asia. Dr. Jalal.
Thank you very much. Distinguished guests, friends, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great honor and privilege to have been asked to give the inaugural address at the Karachi Literary Festival, and I am grateful to the organizers of this event, especially Ameena Saiyid, Asif Farrukhi, and the team at Oxford University Press. Thank you very much. Independence anniversaries are occasions for measured displays of exuberance and mature introspection. On 14th August 2017, Pakistanis will commemorate the 70th anniversary of freedom amid heightened security, economic anxieties, and continuing uncertainties about the impact of a deadly war in neighboring Afghanistan. The insecurity gripping this nuclear-armed country will be especially poignant for those who can still recall the fateful summer of 1947, when the departing colonial masters stood aloof as their erstwhile subjects celebrated their newly won sovereignty with an orgy of horrific bloodletting. Why have human beings become so thirsty for human blood these days? Saad Hassan Manto had asked in his essay, Katlo Khoon Ki Lakeerein. The pity of partition was not that instead of one country, there were now two, independent India and independent Pakistan, Manto mused, but the fact that human beings in both countries were slaves, slaves of bigotry, slaves of religious passions, slaves of animal instincts and barbarity. Then, Muslims were pitted against Hindus and Sikhs in a struggle for national survival. In our own times, the killing of Muslim by Muslim has turned Pakistan into a virtual graveyard of Islam, leading some international commentators to smugly suggest that this is the inevitable fate of a country born in bloodshed and created in the name of religion. The idea of inevitability overlooks the role of human agency and responsibility, as well as the politically contingent nature of historical processes. Fed on officially constructed truths about history, Pakistanis are hard-pressed to understand themselves, far less counter misperceptions about their country at the global level. Instead of critical thinking marked by cautious optimism that might be expected of a people who have weathered many storms in their short but eventful history, including the traumatic dismemberment of the country in 1947-71, a cross-section of Pakistanis are confused and pessimistic. This is much to do with growing economic disparities and the sense of alienation in regions denied their share of resources and political power during prolonged periods of depoliticization under military and quasi-military rule. But the chronic state of national depression in Pakistan stems from a deeper psychological malaise. There have been recurrent doubts about its capacity to survive, and considerable angst about the artificial nature of a state carved out of the predominantly Muslim extremities of the subcontinent. In the brutally blunt metaphor of Britain's last viceroy, Lord Mountbatten, administratively, it was the difference between putting up a permanent building, a nice hut, or a tent. As far as Pakistan is concerned, he went on, we are putting up a tent. We can do no more. Mountbatten had fully expected this fragile tent to collapse. Pakistan has belied the wicked prophecy of the last viceroy. Instead of the tent being replaced with a more permanent building, however, Pakistan has transformed itself metaphorically into what might be called a sprawling military barrack. The rise of the military to a position of political dominance and dominance as a whole within Pakistan's state took place within the very first decade of independence. A combination of domestic, regional, and international factors tilted the balance in favor of the non-elected rather than the elected institutions of the state. Occurring within the context of British-American rivalry, quite as much as the Cold War divide between the Soviet bloc and the West, military dominance had been established as early as 1951, well before the first military coup of 1958. But the very fact of a military takeover suggests that despite the dominance of the bureaucracy and the army, the internal structures of the state were still fluid enough to be threatened by political forces. Pakistan's history is replete with instances of fragmented and semi-organized, even spontaneous opposition movements effectively challenging the state's claims to legitimacy. In 1958, the military and its allies in the civilian bureaucracy felt compelled to abort the incipient political processes before Pakistan could slip into an era of mass mobilization. It proved to be a momentous decision whose legacy is alive and well to this day. The dominance of the military has continued through various phases of Pakistan's political history and will persist, especially if extra constitutional methods are used once again to disrupt the political process. Democracy is not a magic wand waved at election time. Democracy is a process. It can't be turned off and on at will. Democracy is conflict and therefore needs institutions to mediate workable resolutions. Pakistan's survival has come at the cost of weakening democratic processes, which are intrinsic to maintaining a fragile federal equation. There are, however, some key elements of change that could signal a move away from the cycles of military authoritarianism punctuated by short-lived elected governments. The Cold War is over, even if its legacies have endured in Pakistan. In the post-Cold War era, Pakistan is facing a more complex interface between domestic, regional, and international factors that present opportunities and challenges alike. It's worth remembering that it took Pakistan 23 years to hold the first general elections based on universal adult franchise, and it was really only in 2013 that the jinx of failing to ensure a constitutional transfer of power from one civilian government to another was finally broken. In the past, the judiciary typically towed the line laid down by the military and the civilian bureaucracy, and the state-controlled media was invariably cowed into submission. For the first time in Pakistan's 70-year history, the third non-elective institution of the state and the fourth estate are showing some signs of wanting to side on issues that are backed by popular political forces. The role of the United States of America as Pakistan's patron par excellence has given way to belief in a potentially dramatic turn around with the help of China, blowing the tantalizing bugle of its one belt, one road policy. Whether the boons of the China-Pakistan economic corridor will be distributed equally or become another means for private accumulation at public expense will in large part determine this country's future. There is an urgent need for citizens to come together in defense of their political rights, but I would recommend that they begin perhaps with their consumer rights. A civic consumerism can lend substance to social and economic rights of citizenship and in the process help put an end to a kleptocratic political culture. Admittedly, civil society is still relatively unorganized, even though the new internet-based technologies are facilitating novel forms of information dissemination and articulation of social protest. The political party system, of course, remains weakly established and with the constitution repeatedly trammeled upon under the Praetorian jackboot, the rule of law continues to be flouted by the very elements that who are expected to uphold it. Another vital element of detrimental change has been the gathering strength of religious extremism that can be traced back to the military regime of General Ziaul-Haq between 1977 and 1988. The ethical meaning of jihad as striving for a noble endeavor has been completely lost sight of in the temporal maelstroms of Pakistan's politics. Departing from Islamic tradition, today's would-be jihadis have no qualms about jihad being declared and waged by non-state actors. The eagerness to become a shaheed, a martyr, is seen by contemporary militant organizations as sanctifying armed warfare against perceived injustices perpetrated by enemies of Islam, but in exemplifying a widespread desire among militants to become shaheeds and not just ghazis, warriors of the faith, this raises a troubling question about the erosion of an ethics of humanity amid the brutalization of war. What Pakistan has needed more than anything else since its independence is an educational system that can keep pace with the expanding frontiers of knowledge in the rest of the world and inculcate genuine critical thinking. Instead, the knowledge gap has assumed staggering proportions, notably in the social sciences, while critical thinking is the scarcest of all commodities in Pakistan. I do not mean to imply that Pakistanis are uncritical as a people. In fact, it may be said that they are a little too critical about everything and therefore incapable of the kind of well-considered and measured creative activity that can channel national energies into constructive debate and productive enterprise. It is the deficit in analytically coherent critical thought more than anything else which has allowed successive managers of the post-independence Pakistani state to frame the narratives of the nation into implausible molds without being unduly concerned about facing a coherent intellectual challenge, far less a sustained political one. In this disconcerting scenario, the burgeoning of a popular culture in the face of decades of state-sponsored Islamization and terrorism is a remarkable feat for Pakistan. It draws upon the rich and vibrant poetic, musical, and artistic traditions that are well manifested in this country's diverse regional and sub-regional settings. Decades of authoritarianism and state-sponsored nationalism have only strengthened the appeal of regional counter-narratives in artistic productions. Creative engagements with the regional and transnational realms of cultural and intellectual production facilitated by new technologies are producing rich and innovative forms of artistic expression. These are being showcased in the literary festivals that, starting with the Karachi Literary Festival, have been rapidly spreading across the country in recent years. Equally impressive are the extensively telecast Coke Studio sessions, where talented Pakistani musicians are sponsored by the soft drink American multinational to render scintillating new fusions of some of Pakistan's greatest folk and popular songs. There's a rich tradition of musical and artistic creativity in Pakistan that has actively engaged with transnational trends, resulting in innovative blending and fresh departures. The transnational reach of the creative arts has paralleled the globalization of Pakistani music. Building on the works of those who pioneered the modernist phase in Pakistan's painting in the earlier decades, a younger generation of painters is making a creative uses of new ideas and technologies to engage with a dynamic international artistic scene. The dazzling array of new directions in the contemporary arts, literature, and music of Pakistan displays an ongoing tussle between an officially constructed ideology of nationalism and relatively autonomous social and cultural processes in the construction of a national culture. Pakistanis may not be able to compete with the financial resources of India's performing arts and film industry, but they are making their presence felt as independent artists, musicians, writers, and filmmakers in the subcontinent as a whole. Individual success in the swamps of collective failure is not uncommon in an authoritarian state. The price of losing control of the international narratives about Pakistan has been hefty. Despite signs of cultural renewal based on individual creativity, Pakistan has not been able to shake off the stigma of being seen as the epicenter of global terror. While Pakistanis must take part of the blame, much also depends on the openness of the international community to recognize their not so insignificant cultural achievements. These are amply evident in the musical, artistic, literary, and dramatic productions coming out of Pakistan, reflecting the politicization of the personal that comes with the depoliticization of the public arena under authoritarian and semi-authoritarian regimes. If military dictatorships have failed to stunt creative impulses, waves of terror and counter-terror are being resisted through imaginative recourse to local, regional, as well as transnational idioms of a cosmopolitan humanism that celebrates rather than eliminates the fact of difference. Efforts to promote peace and accommodation may appear to you as inconsequential given the aggressive and exclusionary narratives on Muslim identity that have enjoyed state support for over three decades. But the costs of external wars on Pakistani soil have been a potent influence in the rising popular interest in the rich cultural repertoire of the mystical traditions of this country. These conflicting dynamics of moderation versus extremism, openness and engagement with the world versus a narrow and inward-looking closing of the mind signify the battle for the soul of Pakistan that is being waged on several fronts, most perceptibly in Pakistan's literature, music, and the arts. This is not to deny that the magnitude and range of problems besieging Pakistan are so vast that even a competent elected government, or even a series of them, cannot be expected to deliver on all their promises. Learning to live with the shortcomings of chosen representatives without losing faith in the democratic process is going to be difficult for a people who, under years of military rule, have naturalized negative narratives about politics and politicians. If there's one thing Pakistanis might wish to take from their history, in fact, I would say need to take from their history, is that there is a world of difference between an ineffective government that can at least be voted out of office and the abject failure of democratic processes that military interventions invariably signify. The subtle but crucial distinction holds the key to Pakistan's release from interminable cycles of military authoritarianism. It can help trigger the beginnings of a long but arduous journey towards a functioning democracy based on checks and balances between the different institutions of the state. Institution building is a long and painful process, and Pakistanis have not dignified themselves in this crucial realm. If they can overcome this crippling handicap, they may yet lay the basis for a new and more robust federal union based on mutual respect and accommodation among the different constituent units. The citizens of the Muslim homeland created by Muhammad Ali Jinnah whose federalist vision played such a formative role in the creation of Pakistan, have both a self-interest and a moral responsibility to reject the old and tired methods of coercion and neglect of constituent units. It is equally imperative to uphold the Qaeda's singular belief in the rule of law. Pakistan's future historical trajectory will be what the citizens, what you, citizens of Jinnah's Muslim homeland, want it to be. Speaking here in Karachi before the Bar Association on January 10th, 25th, 1948, Muhammad Ali Jinnah had urged, what reason is there for anyone to fear democracy, equality, freedom as the highest standard of integrity and on the basis of fair play and justice for everybody? It remains an aspiration worth striving for, 7 decades after the creation of Pakistan.
Thank you, Dr. Jalal. I now invite Mr. Mustansar Hussain Tarar, a Pakistani author, actor, radio show host, and compere, to deliver his keynote speech. Mr. Tarar has written over 40 books, ranging from travelogues to novels, short stories, and literary criticism. His new book is called Lahore Se Yark and Tak, a travelogue of China.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. میں جو اناؤنسر ہیں ان کی قادر الکلامی سے بہت متاثر ہوا ہوں اور میں نے صرف اندازہ لگایا ہے کہ وہ مجھے طلب کر رہی ہیں ورنہ جو کچھ انہوں نے کہا ہے وہ میرے بارے میں نہیں تھا خواتین و حضرات میں نے اپنی طرف سے تیاری تو بہت کی ہوئی تھی کہ میں بھی ایک فلاسفیکل کی نوٹ یہاں پہ پیش کروں لیکن ہوا یہ کہ شبنم بی بی اسی وقت پنڈال میں داخل ہوئیں اور میرا دل اس زور سے دھڑکا کہ قیامت کر دوں یہ ہماری جوانی کے فلیم تھیں محبوب تھیں اور اب بھی ہیں میں ان کو ان کے اوریجنل کنٹری پاکستان میں خوش آمدید کہتا ہوں بے شک یہ میرے لیے ایک منفرد اعزاز ہے کہ مجھے ایسے آگست اور الوہی اجتماع کے سامنے کی نوٹ ایڈریس کے لیے منتخب کیا گیا دراصل عبداللہ حسین اور انتظار حسین کے بعد کی نوٹ ایڈریس کا ہما میرے سر پر آ کے بیٹھ گیا ہے اگرچہ میں اس کا اہل نہیں ہوں دراصل اس ہما کو عادت ہے کہ کسی نہ کسی ادبی حسین کے سر پر بیٹھنے کی کیونکہ اب فکشن کے 3 حسینوں میں سے میں ہی فی الحال زندہ ہوں تو وہ مجبوراً میرے سر پر آ کے بیٹھ گیا ہے اس سے آپ اندازہ لگائیے کہ میں کس طرح اپنی جان جوکھوں میں ڈال کے آج یہاں پہ آیا اس محفل کی میرے لیے ایک کشش یہ بھی ہے کہ دوسری کی نوٹ سپیکر عائشہ جلال ہیں اور ہم دونوں گئے زمانوں میں اجڑ چکے لکشمی مینشن میں ہمسائے ہوا کرتے تھے اس کی دھول آلود گراؤنڈ میں ان کے بھائی شاہد جلال اور منٹو صاحب کی بیٹیاں سب بچہ لوگ ادھم مچایا کرتے تھے اچھا اس سے آپ کیلکولیٹ نہ کرنے بیٹھ جائیے گا کہ ہماری عمریں کیا ہیں دنیا بھر میں وہ ہماری سول سپوکس ویمن ہیں یہاں تک کہ میرے بچوں نے ان کی کتابوں کے رٹے لگا کر سول سروس میں شاندار پوزیشنیں حاصل کی مجھے خوشی ہے اور آکسفورڈ کی وجہ سے ایک زمانے کے بعد ہم دونوں پھر ہمسائے ہو گئے اب یہ جو کلیدی خطبہ ہے یعنی ادب کے خزانے کی کنجی ہے اس سے ان دنوں تو کوئی مکفل دروازہ نہیں کھلتا میرے پاس جتنی چابیاں ہیں وہ سب کی سب زنگ آلود ہو چکی ہیں اور دروازے بھی کب سے بند پڑے ہیں کھلتے ہی نہیں چلیے ان میں سے کسی ایک دروازے کو دھکیل کر کنجی گھما کر کھول لیتے ہیں اور اس میں جھانکتے ہیں اور وہاں ایک جلاہا افسانوں سفرناموں اور ناولوں کے کھیس اپنی کھڈی پر بننے کی کوشش کر رہا ہے लेकिन उसकी समझ में ये नहीं आता कि वो उस पर कैसे नक्श तस्वीर करे, गंगा जमनी गुल बूटे काढ़े या सिंध और पंजाब के पानियों को अपनी तख्लीक का आब जमजम बनाए। आखिर एक पाकिस्तानी नसर निगार किस तहजीब, सकाफत, रस्म और रिवाज और लहजे को अपनाए, ऐसे किरदारों को अपनाए जो उसकी रोज़मर्रा ज़िंदगी में नहीं बल्कि गुज़श्ता अदब में नुमाया होते हैं, या उन लोगों के नैन नक्श मुसव्वर करे जिनके दरमियान वो पला बड़ा है। मैं जानता हूँ कि ये सवाल भीड़ों के छत्ते में हाथ डालने के मुतरादिफ है, लेकिन आज तक मुझे इतनी भीड़ों ने काटा है कि मैं उनके जहर से इम्यून हो चुका हूँ। उर्दू ज़ुबान की रिवायती तहजीब, रख रखाव और लहजे की पैरवी करना, कौसरो तस्नीम में धुली हुई ज़ुबान लिखना मेरे बस में नहीं, गंगा और जमुना मेरे दरिया नहीं, इसलिए मैं कतई तौर पर आशना नहीं हूँ कि उनके पानियों में कौन सी तासीर। मेरी तहरीरों को सिर्फ पंजाब, सिर्फ रावी, चनाब और सिंध के पानी सैराब कर सकते हैं कि मैं इनके जंगल बेलों में उगने वाला वो बूटा हूँ जिसे अपनी तख्लीकी नमूद के लिए सिर्फ इनके जरखेज पानी दरकार। याशार कमाल महमूद मैहॉक के जो मुसन्निफ टर्किश, उन्होंने कहा है कि जब तक एक तख्लीककार अपने वतन के दरियाओं, नदियों और फसलों और मौसमों को नहीं जानता, यहाँ तक कि किसी जंगल के दरमियान एक तालाब में ज़िंदगी करते कीड़ों मकोड़ों के बारे में आगाही नहीं रखता, वो एक बड़ा नावल निगार नहीं बन सकता। हम में से कितने हैं जो अपने वतन को जानते हैं? और अक्सर मुझे महसूस होता था कि जब मैं कराची ख़ास तौर पर आता था, यानी ऑक्सफोर्ड से पहले, कि ये मुख्तलिफ जज़ीरे हैं, हम एक दूसरे को बिल्कुल नहीं जानते। कराची एक जज़ीरा है, क्वेटा एक जज़ीरा है, पेशावर है और लाहौर है, और हम सब अपनी अपनी दुनियाएं बसाए बैठे हैं, अपने अपने अदीबों को प्रोजेक्ट कर रहे हैं, अपने अपने लहजों को सामने ला रहे हैं, अपनी अपनी तहजीब की तरवीज कर रहे हैं, इनमें मुश्तरक कोई बात नहीं। मुझे खुशी इस बात की है कि ऑक्सफोर्ड ने कम अज़ कम कराची और इस्लामाबाद के दरमियान एक पुल बना दिया, ये जज़ीरे नहीं रहे। मेरी ख्वाहिश है कि वो लाहौर भी आएँ, क्योंकि लाहौर को इन जज़ीरों को मिलाए बगैर उर्दू अदब मुकम्मल नहीं हो सकता। दूसरी, ये वैसे ही लाइट टोन है, आज किसी ने हवाला भी दिया मेरे और इंतज़ार हुसैन के हवाले से, मुझसे छेड़छाड़ करते रहते थे अक्सर, और वो भी ज़ुबान के मामले में, क्योंकि मैं कतई तौर पर वो जो है बा मुहावरा उर्दू लिखने पर कादिर नहीं हूँ, बल्कि मैं ये समझता हूँ कि मुहावरों का सहारा सिर्फ वो लोग लेते हैं जो किसी भी सूरत हाल को बयान करने से जब कासिर हो जाते तो मुहावरे की बैसाखी थाम लेते। अलबत्ता तंज़ो मिज़ाह के लिए इसका तड़का लगाना मुस्तासिम होता है। यूँ भी उर्दू ज़ुबान के बेशतर मुहावरों का लोकाल गैर मुल्की, कि यहाँ उल्टे बांस बरेली को कहाँ जाते हैं और हम सुबह बनारस से भी आगाह नहीं। ये छोटा सा इंसिडेंट है, मेरी भी बेटी छठी जमात में पढ़ती थी कुरतुलैन, एक रोज़ बहुत हैरान परेशान हालत में घर आई, कहने लगी कि अबू ये राधा कौन थी? तो मैंने कहा तुम्हें इससे क्या कि राधा कौन थी? कहने लगी नहीं, मैं ये जानना चाहती हूँ कि अगर उसके पास नौमन तेल नहीं होता था तो वो नाचते क्यों नहीं? अब आप मुझे बताइए कि उसको मैं कैसे समझा सकता हूँ कि इस मुहावरे का पस मंज़र क्या है। अच्छा, इसके ये अलग बहस है कि उन मुहावरों को किस तरह तब्दील किया जाए या उनकी जगह नए मुहावरे जो हमारे मुकामी सकाफत और मौसमों से ताल्लुक रखती हैं वो किस तरह इंट्रोड्यूस किए जाएं। बहरहाल, तो इंतज़ार साहब के साथ इस मौजू पर। अच्छा, एक और चीज़ जो मैं थोड़ा सा खदशा मोल ले रहा हूँ, पहले भी लिया, चलिए एक और दरवाज़ा मुकफ़ल खोलने की सही करते हैं। मैं अपनी जंगालू चाबी घुमाता हूँ तो उसके अंदर दर्जनों संपोलिए कुलबुलाते रींगते, मजहबी जबर तासब तंग नजरी के सपोलिए फन फैलाए अपनी दुमों पर खड़े होकर आपकी तहरीरों को डसने के लिए। ये सपोलिए पहले वहाँ नहीं थे, एक आमिर के अहद में इनकी पनीरी लगाई गई और अब माशाल्लाह वो जवान होकर फुंकारते फिरते हैं। पिछले 20-30 वर्षों में एक अजीब तब्दीली रूनमा हुई। तब अहले इक्तदार आप पर इस मुल्क की चांदनी हराम करार देते हुए आपकी तहरीरों की पादाश में या तो आपको कोड़े लगाते थे या फिर रिस्क रोजगार के दरवाजे बंद कर देते। लेकिन अब सूरत हाल अक्सर बदल गई, यानी मेज़ें उलट गई हैं। आज अहले इक्तदार को कुछ परवाह नहीं कि आप क्या लिखते हैं, यूं भी वो पढ़ नहीं सकते। आज ये मुआशरा है, लाखों लोग हैं जो तंग नजरी, हुरमत और तासब के ताजियाने लिए आपके बैरी हो गए। तब अहले इक्तदार आपकी गोशमाली करते थे और मुआशरा आपकी जुर्रत रिंदाना पर शाबाश कहता था। मुआशरा आपके हलीफ था, आपके पीछे खड़ा था, वो अप्रिशिएट करता था कि ये लोग एक आमिर के ख़िलाफ़ या जाबराना निज़ाम के खिलाफ खड़े हुए हैं और जद्दोजहद कर रहे हैं। अब वही मुआशरा जो है वो आपके हर लफ्ज़ को खिलाफ शरा करार देकर आपको लिंच कर देना चाहता। तब चंद एक सलीबें थीं और अब गली गली में सलीबें गाड़ दी गईं। किससे मुंसफी चाहे? नासिर काजमी ने कहा था कि आए हैं इस गली में तो पत्थर ही ले चलें। आज सूरत हाल ये है कि आए हैं इस गली में तो एक ब्लॉगर ही ले चलें। ब्लॉगर गायब, आज़ादी इजहार गायब, आसमान खा गया, ज़मीन खा गई, ये क्या करिश्मा है? क्या अलफ लैला का कोई जिन या सामरी जादूगर आज भी मौजूद है कि वो छू करता है और उस शख्स का पता ही नहीं चलता कि वो कहाँ जाता है? ना अदारों को पता, ना फौज को पता, तो किसको पता होगा? मैं मज़ीद खदशा मोल नहीं लेना चाहता कि अभी मैं नहीं चाहता कि मैं अभी गायब कर दिया जाऊँ। पिछले दिनों वज़ीर-ए-आज़म साहब के किसी अदबी मुशीर ने उन्हें रियायत लफ्जी की एक तरकीब सुझाई और उन्होंने अदीबों से कहा कि अब ज़रब अदब के बाद ज़रब कलम की बारी। खूब तालियां पीटी गईं, लेकिन हजूर आपका इकबाल बुलंद हो, कलम हथौड़ा नहीं होता जिससे ज़रब लगाई जाती है और ना ही अदीब लोहार होता। कलम तो सुरखाब का वो नाजुक और रंगीन पर है जिससे खलके खुदा के ज़ख्मों पर मरहम लगाई जाती, ज़िल्लतों के मारे लोगों की खराशों पर फाये रखे जाते हैं। कलम हथौड़ा नहीं होता। अगरचे मैं अपनी जंग आलूद कलीद से कुछ मज़ीद दरवाज़े भी खोल सकता हूँ, लेकिन वक्त कम है तो मैं इज्तनाब करता हूँ। ऐन मुमकिन है कि मेरी इस तहरीर से, मुख्तसर तहरीर से, आपको गुमान हो कि मैं कनूती शख्स रजाइयत से गुरेज करता हूँ, तो ऐसा हरगिज नहीं। मैंने हमेशा एक स्याह बादल के किनारों पर उम्मीद की किरणें फूटती देखता, नाउम्मीदी को रद्द करता। ज़हीर काश्मीरी के इस शेर को अपना मंशूर करता हूँ कि हमें खबर है कि हम हैं चिराग़ आखरे शब, हमें खबर है कि हम हैं चिराग़ आखरे शब, हमारे बाद अंधेरा नहीं उजाला है। शुक्रिया।
बहुत शुक्रिया तारर साहब। आपके सफ़रनामों से वैसे तो हमारी अलमारी भरी पड़ी है, बट और सफ़र का शौक़ भी पढ़ पढ़ के ही हुआ। थैंक यू वेरी मच फॉर दिस। आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक ऑल द ऑनर्ड गेस्ट फॉर द टाइम एंड आई एम वी आर नाउ गोइंग टू बी गेटिंग द स्टेज रेडी फॉर अ परफॉर्मेंस by Shema Sayed. So thank you very much for your time and I hope you will enjoy the festival. Thank you our guests. Please remain seated, ladies and gentlemen. We will now, the performance will soon be starting. We're getting the stage ready for a performance by Shema Sayed.